Good. So today, the topic is introductions. This will be articles. From the electrical engineering, and I included. This is the article that you received during the very first session. So I included that into the mix. So what you have in front of you are two different. New articles. One is considered a long one, it's 10 pages. The other one is, as you will see on the name of the journal, one is called Transactions on Circuits and Systems Express Briefs, which means it's either 5 pages or less. And basically what we are going to do is, first of all, talk about what should go into introduction. What is the introduction for, and how actually sort of introduction prepares the reader for the details that you are going to present in an article, and then the format differences. How you do it when you are writing a very long article, 10 pages and more, and when you're writing a short article, which is usually more focused. And we will always, every week we talk about different topic, but we will always mention everything that we discussed before, which means titles and abstracts. Okay, so right, so this is the first one. As you will see, this article. So how many of you have this with you, this article with you, and how many you are missing? How many are missing? 1, 2, 3. Okay, good. So I only brought 8 copies. Okay, so when you look at this article, this was published recently in IEEE Transactions on a very large scale integration systems. So it's you look at the title, and you can immediately see that the article is very, very specific. It's describing one invention. And the invention is that hybrid 1-bit full adder circuit. And then it highlights a couple important aspects or metrics about this invention, and that it's low power and it's high speed. And power performance analysis just describes what is mainly the paper about. So it's looking at performance analysis of this new hybrid 1-bit full adder circuit. So this is very typical. So if you have a journal, and this could be very, very well your case, where the journal is a very technical journal, it's as I said, this in this particular case, transactions on VLSI systems. So very tight community of researchers published in this journal. And so the expectations that the reviewers have when they see a brand new submission is very different in this journal as opposed to some of the examples we had before where you're in a conference when you're talking to a much broader audience and mainly non-experts. So it's a very different goal. Okay, so here, and same way we need to look at the abstract. As we mentioned last week, what the abstracts are, the abstracts essentially set the reader and supposed to excite the reader to read the rest of the article. Because if you don't capture the reader in the abstract, then he'll put it away and say, and then, you know, it's probably not interesting. The abstract is always, as we said, has an introduction where basically it sets the motivation. Okay. Now, many cases, and this is what I mentioned last week, is the size of the introduction changes based on whether you need to really explain where this article is supposed to be, or this bulk of work in some kind of larger, concept. Or it can, like in this case, it can go straight to what the article is about. And this is very typical in highly technical journals. So basically, you don't need to explain why you're motivated by this. Everybody understands that. And just straight go into what the paper talks about. And you can see that narrative builds up. So you describe slightly what is the behind the scenes about the work, and then as you can see the bottom of this abstract, you summarize all the results, and the results are very, very specific. And they relate to what you were claiming in your title, those two main points, low power and high speed. So you invented something that is brand new, and it's better than anything before. And the two main metrics that you are evaluating your new invention is on the high speed and low power. Okay, so then the results that you are summarizing here are extremely specific to that point. That's why you see, real values for power consumption under specific conditions, and delay under specific conditions, and some other details. So, and then a summary of how it compares to sort of the state of the art that existed until this invention. Okay, so this is abstract, very, very specific, very technical, a lot of detail that actually is a summary of what the entire work is about. Now, so this is, when you count the number of pages, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, okay. So anything that is more than 5 pages is considered a long paper. So this one has 8, which is kind of average for a long paper. Which means that you treat the paper as a substantial body of work. Okay, so what that means is, let me zoom out so we have it. You can see how the introduction, these particular authors spent a page, two full columns, because it continues on the second page. Pretty much setting the scene. So what is the introduction? The introduction has to describe what is the situation in the area that you're doing research, or the area where you are reporting these new results. What is the current, the latest, the most modern situation that is reported in the literature, okay? You can only describe things that are in public domain. You cannot say, such and such guy sent me an email that they invented something, because nobody else can have access to that communication. And so only things that are accessible in a public domain should be reported here. And so this is where most of your references, and this is, I mentioned that at the beginning of this class, how right, how is it important to plan out your submission? So this is the place where you do your homework. You're targeting certain journal. You need to find out who are, you know, if any the researchers that are in your competition. So basically, you are doing research in the same area, are sitting on the board and on the editorial board, because it's very likely that they will be the ones who will get the article to review it and will decide who will be the reviewers that will look at it. And this is very important. So this planning stage is very important, because one of the first reasons why papers are rejected is that people look at the references. And if they see that there are two things that they are searching for, that you referenced, your references are up to date. That means you don't reference, you know, papers that are from 10 years ago or 15 years ago, you know, because it just gives the impression that you couldn't find anything, so nobody did anything about this area for 10 years, which means it's probably irrelevant, or it's why nobody paid attention, because people tried to investigate, it came to a conclusion that you know, it's a waste of time. So that's one, okay? That you need to have papers that are fairly recent, and what that means is the last 5 years. Anything that is older than 5 years is considered, in our area that is changing so rapidly, is considered, you know, too old. So that's one thing. Are your references from recent times? And the number two is that you gave credit to all the people that are working on in that area as well. That you actually searched, went through all the references, all the entire body of work that was reported in the literature, and you included in the reference list. And of course, including people from the editorial board on the reference list is, advantageous in many ways. Okay. So that's, we'll discuss this a little bit more when we will be on the other side, when we look at the papers as reviewers. Today, you know, the publication of works is so competitive that the main role for these editorial boards is to protect the credibility of that journal. And so they will try to find anything in your paper that could be used as a reason for rejection, because they want to keep the quality high and keep on improving it. So this is their number one goal. So knowing, you know, these little things that can avoid giving them an opportunity to say something, you know, that you're missing X, Y, Z things in your paper, and those are the most important to have there, is important. So that's. As you can see here, all those references are going to the introduction. So this particular paper has 25 references. It was published in just recently, October 2015. And you can see the references, how old they are. Right? So reference number one, 2007, then 2006, 2006, 3, 2001, 97, 2005, 2, 10, 1999, 2003, 2011, and so on. So you can see that they are fairly, there is nothing super modern. And the reason is, as I told you when we talked about this article before, this is my area of research. And there have been so many full header designs in the past 20 years. There are literally hundreds and hundreds and hundreds. And so people are just tired of another full header design. So it has to be really, really good, right? So they clearly have something that is not super old or outdated. And another important aspect is, and this you need to understand from the, and this is as well, I mentioned this to you before, that you need to understand the role that the publishers have in this business. Oh, I thought you were a law student. Okay, the role that the publishers have this. Their number one is to increase the credibility of that journal, and you increase it by the impact factor. And how you increase the impact factor is that the papers that are published in this journal are cited. And so it's very important, and this is a big plus, that you look at the references, you can count how many papers out of these references are papers from this journal. And this is done intentionally. Okay, you can see number two, all right, then you have number seven, number eight, and so on. There are several. So this is very important. You don't have to have all of them because that kind of would be obvious that you're just sucking up. And then maybe the work is not as good because you're trying to use these tricks. However, having several of the articles from the same journal, you just eliminate another, weakness out from your manuscript and something that they will not be the reviewers critical of. Okay, so. Okay, so let's go to the introduction. As I said, for long papers, and we will see that on the other, one of the other new papers, this is, the introduction is where you describe the larger scope of this area of research. Your motivation, as you can see, is this first paragraph is the motivation behind the work. They're trying to set, they understand when you read this, they understand that this is a not very popular area anymore. And so they have to really convince the reviewers that their invention is so relevant and so good that this has to be published. People need to know about it. Right? So they set the stage. The area, how important it is, and then you can see how you include a lot of, and I mentioned this, that you want to give credit, even people who are only marginally relevant to the work itself, but you put them in a kind of a, general statements, that where some part of the article they published has some relevance to this work. And this is what you see very frequently, that you kind of lump a number of different references into a single statement, right? So this is how you give credit. Because all these people that publish these papers, now they will get credit for citation. Right? And that's one of the main things how, you know, researchers are evaluated. How good is your work? If your papers get cited, then that means you're working on something relevant. And then it goes into specifics. So there's the introduction, and then all these individual references that are sort of lumped here in that group are individually mentioned, where each one of them, you know, there's a dedicated sentence to that work explaining the relevance to this work, okay, how it is connected. And some people try to be, critical of that previous work, because you have to set the tone that the work that you are presenting here in this paper is an improvement of whatever you are comparing yourself to or you're referring to, okay? You improve the design, or you completely change it that it's order of magnitude better. So you don't try to discredit the previous work. You know, you reference it, but you can. It's all right to, I would say, mildly criticize it. Okay, so point out some limitations that the previous work had. And without saying that, oh, you know, that was just garbage, why was it published? So don't try to attack those previous researchers, but set a tone. What were the limitations? Describe the limitations of that work. Oftentimes, this is something that is required in every paper. So you describe your own work, but it's not, you know, solving the, you know, all the problems. It has, it delivers improvements, or it's better than what was there before, but usually it's under specific conditions and there are limitations. And so you will be expected to describe, to be honest about it, that you are not just trying to make really bold claims that, you know, this solves everything and nobody needs to work on this anymore, because you're the one who solved it for the last time. Okay? So that's very important. All right? So you can see, you go through specific details, and then you have, sometimes you have a group of references that could be that it's actually the same research group. It's that published several papers on on that investigation, right? And you had the discussion before on using this et al. Basically, a lot of papers, especially papers coming from Asia, is very typical, where you don't have a single author or a very small group. Usually, you have their philosophy is to give even probably the janitor was cleaning the floors after everybody left home deserves to get credit for that work. So it will be mentioned that they'll have, you know, 40 people in the authors list, because everybody did their job and everybody's job was important. Who is the lead, right? Who is the first one is the one who did, who was either the main contributor to the work, or who did majority of the work, or who led the team, or whatever. There's some importance about that, and that's why the name is then recognized. It's about name recognition. If your name is the first, it means that you were the most important person on that piece of work. Okay? Sometimes, it's not that often, but in certain places and certain cultures, the people will count, you know, what if you have your name appears in a long list of authors' name, they will try to count, you know, further away you're from the front, that means you were less, you're contributing less and less and less. And but it's not true, you know, all the time. Majority of the times these things are used just randomly. The only thing is that the first author is the one that is deserves the most of the credit because did the majority of the work.
Okay. All right. Now,
The conclusion of the introduction section. When you look at this, you can see, and it's almost like a direct copy of the abstract, the conclusion of the abstract. And so, and why this is used? Because these results are the most important. These are the results that the reviewer has to remember. And so it is a very common practice to repeat that message over and over and over again. So that's why it appears in the abstract, it appears in the end of the introduction, okay? And then it starts the description of the work,
right? And then we will talk about, later on, we'll talk about conclusion. So once the, you know, you overwhelm the reader with all the technical information and everything, but then you write conclusion, and everything else, you know, all those results appear again. As you can see, the conclusion, the last statement, all right, and you have the same thing again. All those data you repeat because you want that reviewer to remember that again. So this is, you know, what is the most important. You know, you can see. The proposed food editor offered 20.56% improvement with respect to the best reported design in terms of the power efficiency, the power delay product. 27.3% improvement, you know, implementing 90 nanometer technology, and so on, right? So these are the main contributions, the results that you want the reviewer to remember. So, okay, now, going back here. We'll talk about, next time, we'll talk about how to construct the body of work. And a picture is worth 1,000 words, very true. But it has to be a picture that is clearly legible, and it has to, every picture has to have a meaning, and it has to be clear why it is there. So the reader is learning something that you cannot really describe in words. So we'll get to that next time. Okay, now I want to come here. Yeah, we'll look at that long paper first. So the two papers that I gave you today, the new ones, okay. So again, here, so this is the longer paper, IEEE transactions on circuits and systems, called, you know, dash regular papers, okay? I think it's about 11 pages long, and so it's a long paper. That means you treat it that way. Again, this is a very, very specialized technical journal, excuse me, and therefore, when you construct a title, you are displaying the main points. So what is the paper about? It's about a DC-DC converter. So it's a voltage converter, converts one level of voltage to another. and it's for energy harvesting applications specifically, right? So that's what it is describing. And now, what is special about it? What is the main invention? There are two things, or three. 15 nanoamps, that means it operates in very, very low current. 300 nanowatts, that's how much power it consumes, that's important. And it's sensitive. Obviously, those are the three main things that are different from when this work is compared to anything else that was published in the public domain before that. And again, when the abstract is constructed, same as you can see here, there is an introduction, because you look for the sentence that starts this paper or something with paper, and it's down here, it's like fifth line down, or sixth line. So this is your introduction where you describe the motivation behind the work. Okay? Maximum power point tracking DC-DC boost converter to harvest energy from sub-microwatt power sources is presented. So this is where you situate your body of work. What is the general area? And then the paper describes, and again, main point are the data. This is what captures the reviewers and or the reader's attention. You always give very, very specific data and show what the main invention is or main contribution is. You know, it does, you know, improve efficiency. Whatever it is, right? You specifically describe it. And now, because, again, going to the introduction, because it's a long paper, it's a long introduction. And you can see, typically, these Roman numbers are used to describe different sections of the paper. Once you are inside the section, so as a subsection, then you switch to letters. So you can see that the introduction, actually, within the introduction, these authors divided the focus into specific parts of that circuit itself, right, or the operation. And so that's why you have, again, in general, this is the motivation, and this is where you give credit to other people. Okay, you specifically create these, again, group references for different aspects of your work, how they're relevant to what was published. And then, you know, some of the publications might target certain specific area in this work. That's why the authors divide it into to these four sections. Right. See, there are four important issues to be addressed in energy harvesting from ambient sources, A, B, C, D. And so then you focus your literature review specifically on each of those, or not you, but the authors, right? So, and why it is divided like this? Because the paper represents clearly a major contribution, a major project, and so it is important that every aspect of that project is described. Okay? And then within each of these, now, as I said, so some of the references actually refer to one particular part of the energy harvesting, and so that's where you, in more detail, you describe that previous work, what was in the literature, in 3-4, this happened, you know, number 10, this is not very, starting a sentence with a reference like this is, I'd say, not preferred.
It's really incorrect. It shouldn't be done. So you if I was a reviewer, I would point this out, because you want to give credit to the authors. You want to mention the group by name. And so it is much more preferred, and you will be looked at much more favorably when you introduce somebody's work. And like you we saw it on the previous paper, you mentioned the first, at least if there are many authors, you mention the first author and then you use the et al. Phrase. And you put the reference at the end of the sentence, the reference number. All right, that way, somebody's name is specifically mentioned in the work. Okay, it looks much better, and you know, you will make friends. They will remember it. If you do it this way, then basically you don't care, you know, it says that you don't care about the people behind the work, it's just a number. Right, so that's just a little sort of side note. Okay, and so it's going on and on and on, and you can see it's just the introduction. It ends in the end of the second page, right? So it has all the four areas, A, B, C, and D, and then, again, capturing the reader, they created a section saying our work. So now they mention everybody else. What was the sort of in the literature, state of the art, in this area, and now this is what our work is, and this is how we contributed to this work. And they spent half a page describing that, because you want to, again, it's about reiterating the message to the reader that the takeaway is what is the major contribution here in my paper. Now you have this, you know, this is almost required or expected in long papers. Oh, okay, I just want to one more additional thing here. Let's just briefly, quickly look at the references. Okay. References, and you can see that the majority of them, you know, in this case, you can see this is IEEE Journal Solid State Circuits, Transaction Computers, Solid State Circuits, Solid State Circuits, Solid State Circuits. Da, da, da. You can see that the one particular journal is repeated. This is where most of the the researchers in this area, where they publish the work.
Is that one article remaining? Is that one article remaining?
Oh yes, over here, sorry. Okay, and it goes on, you can see. This is where they publish. So now, this journal, this particular journal, is a different one, all right? So it is clear that probably this is the main group. This is the group that does research in this area. And they don't publish in these transactions, because this transaction belonged to Circuits and Systems Society, whereas this journal belongs to Solid State Circuits Society. So it's a different group of people. And now, one thing is that you are, you know, the even though it's within just the IEEE, it's one technical professional society, but these journals and these societies within the IEEE are in competition with each other. And so there is a lot of overlap. Where you can have your work published. You can choose multiple of these journals.
And so a lot of time is that these journals that typically do not publish material in certain area welcome if there is a paper in that area, because it can start now a new trend. And as I said, they are in a business of improving and increasing their own reputation. Since we are here, conclusion, have, you know, notice again, summarizing specific results, again, with the reader, so the reader takes away the main message is, these are the improvements, this is what we contribute, this is the main piece of information that they need to remember. Okay, now the last article, similar area, but now this is a different journal, Transaction Certificate Systems, and it's called Express Briefs. These are typically 4 pages, and then you can purchase one more page. So the longest you can have it is 5. Cannot be longer than 5. And now, what it means is that you have significantly less space to describe the same, you know, same results or same maybe body of work. And so you have to be much more focused. So first, how you take advantage is that the titles in these kind of articles, these brief ones, tend to be longer, because you're trying to put as much information about your work already. You use every space that is available to you to promote your work. And so you can see here, this is what it is. The work is about time interleaved, analog to digital converter, and you know, successive approximation. That's the acronym here. So that's what it is about. And now there are all these data that you put in. This is what makes this analog to digital converter so special. It has sampling rate, 220 mega samples per second. It's 9-bit. It's 2x. It has 133 femtofarads input capacitance. Figure of merit is 37 femtojoules per conversion. So that's, you know, how much power it will consume per single conversion. And it's implemented in 65 nanometer CMOS process. So all these pieces of data makes this work, this design, very, very special. Okay? Otherwise, you know, why would they be mentioning it? Excuse me. So everything has to be, because you are reporting in much smaller space, you have to be much more focused. So abstract is much shorter, and you go straight, you don't care about motivation or whatever, you go straight to the point. This brief presents this, and these are the results. Okay? Introduction, much shorter. Now you can see that it's less than, you know, it's like half a page. You provide some motivation, but then you go straight to the literature review, and you provide the bulk of your review. And then at the end of it, here, you basically introduce the reviewer to your own design. So you prepare we'll be talking about it, is that, you know, these sections of these different sections of the paper, they are not really standalone. They have to create a flow, kind of a flow of information. So always one end of one section should be an introduction to the following section. Okay. So point is here that when you are writing a paper for these briefs, or it's a shorter paper, or there are other papers for letters with various names depending on your area. Then you have to be very, very specific from the beginning because you have much significantly less space. However, right, still you should focus your group, so the number of references tend to be also smaller because of the space limitation. Okay, so you see there you have here it's 17 in this case, and you again give everybody credit. Everybody is mentioned here, and you incorporate these references into your storyline here, into your literature review. Any questions? So what I would like now, homework for next time, is remember when you selected your own article that you added to the mix? So look at that article that you selected that is from your area, and write a little analysis, as we said here. So first of all, we already covered abstract. How long is the abstract? Does it have an introduction, or is it more focused? How long is the introduction? How many references? Is it a long paper? Is it a short paper? So you look at these are common features across. That doesn't matter what the area or what the topic of that journal is. This goes across different domains. Okay, and then email it to me again. Now we'll have a break. Thank you.
Okay.
Just
start
yours.
Definitely.
Definitely. I will
be here.
Okay.
Okay.
It'll be great.
Could you make that?
Yeah, someone here.
One working. outside.
Yes, yes, I'll just go. So I'll just write it.
All right, if anybody needs like, you know, 5 minute break, because you are working so hard, no, we'll just, okay. All right. Okay, so so this second part, everybody received the two new articles. I tried to place them in front of everybody. So this is, so today the articles are from electrical engineering. And the first one is the one from the group that I gave you during the first, very first meeting that we had. And I added a couple more today. So the topic of today, what we are going to look at is introductions. And the difference we will discuss is when you are writing a paper where the targeted journal is, or you're writing a long paper, okay, which means 6 pages, double column or more, or if you're writing a short paper, which is typically 5 pages, double column or less. All right. So that's why what you see are 3 articles from 3 different journals. This one is from Transactions on Very Large Scale Integration Systems. And then this one is Transactions on Circuits and Systems. Okay. Express briefs, so these are short. This is a journal that publishes short papers. And the last one is Transactions on Circuits and Systems, regular papers. So these are long papers. And depending on what your what kind of paper you're writing, we take different approach. How we construct, we talked about titles, how we construct abstracts, and how we construct introduction and corresponding reference list. All right. So let's start with the first one. So typically these journal papers, the articles that we discussed before, last week, and also the homework that you had, those were conference papers. And when you're writing a conference paper, it really matters what kind of conference it is and what is the audience that you're talking to and what is really the purpose of you presenting that work there. Journal papers are typically for technical and very specialized audience, right? In this case, you know, this is a journal paper, IEEE transactions on very VLSI systems. So basically, it publishes any kind of work that is related to designing, you know, any chip design or, you know, part of the circuit or computer system or whatever system. So some kind of hardware down to a level like in this one, in this case, you know, 1-bit full edit. Which is basically a basic building block of any kind of computational or arithmetic circuit in any kind of system. So when you are writing a journal paper for this very specialized and very technical audience, you spend less time trying to write it or, you know, about your motivation, because everybody who is reading it, you know, these are your colleagues that work probably in an area that is the same or similar. And you all know what the motivation is. So you don't need to write about it. It's like reinventing the wheel, as we say. So that's why you have very typical when you even construct the construction of an abstract. Remember last week we were talking about that the abstract has, you can identify it, it has a sort of motivational part, some kind of introduction, and then the body of the abstract where actually you describe what is inside the paper. In a journal paper, usually you very typically the introduction is very, very small, or like in this case, none whatsoever. You go straight what the paper is about. And you describe, basically the circumstances of your investigation, what you're investigating. And you spend a big chunk of the abstract in giving very detailed data that actually support the reason why this has to be published. So you are basically telling these guys, these reviewers, that your work and the results that you obtain from this study are so important that they have to publish it and everybody else has to know about it. There is no other way. And so you are trying to make that convincing argument. So as you can see, very, very detailed. You provide specific data, specific results, and you catch their attention immediately. And also construction of a title. This is all related. Title, abstract, and introduction that follows has to be, they form kind of a one block that introduces your investigation or your paper, what it is about. Title also very specific. Here you can tell, you always describe what is the paper about. It's about a one bit full adder circuit. So that is the main design or the main, the main investigation that you were doing. And the thing that what is special about this is that it's hybrid, it's high speed, and it's low power. And what you are showing here is performance analysis. So the title captures what is the essence, what is that result, one thing that you invented, and then you use a variety of sort of key phrases that describe what is the main, where lies the novelty that you achieved here. All right. So that's what these are, these keywords. Now, the other thing is what you should see. If I am writing a long paper, then, see, in this case, the paper has 25 references, which is standard for, usually it should be at least 20. So 25 is average. What is also very important is that, remember during that our first meeting, I told you that you need to understand that the publishers of these journals it's a business for them, and how they can improve on their product is that they are very, very interested in increasing and improving the reputation of that journal. And the reputation of a journal is directly connected to the impact factor. And the impact factor comes from citations. And so, when you are writing a paper and you are targeting a particular journal, let's say in this case, these guys, very smartly, they want to publish their work in transactions on BLSI. So you make sure that some of those 25 references are actually referencing papers from that journal. Because that's how you are acknowledging and giving sort of credit to the journal itself that this is very highly respectable journal and you want to have your work published by them. So that's why you see right, reference number two, right? And then you see reference number seven. Seven, and there could be some conferences.
Circuit
19. All right. So you can see. Yeah. So at least these three, and there could be maybe one more, are papers that were published by this journal. So the journal and the editor and editorial board will look at it favorably. This is, you know, otherwise, if you don't put it there, you can bet that they will point out. They will not say, oh, you know, you didn't reference one of our papers, but they will say, well, your references are incomplete. You're missing some important ones. And, you know, those important ones they consider were published in that journal So this is very important to remember. Okay? And now, who do you put it on the references? So you are targeting a specific journal, you find out who is on the editorial board of the journal, who is responsible for your area. It's usually very, very well documented. They have a number of board members that are responsible for specific areas. And if you see somebody who happens to work also in your area, the area that you're going to publish, you make sure that their work is also mentioned there, okay? Because that's another important credit that you will earn. And that will result that what ultimately you are interested in, to have your paper published. That's number one goal. All right, so then now we come to introduction. So if it's a long paper, the introduction can be fairly substantial. As you can see in this case, it's over a page long. You can see it goes all the way to section two, starts on the second page right here. And one thing is, you can see, when I construct the introduction, I start with the motivation. All right, so this is where you still put it. You don't necessarily put it in the abstract, but you still include a very brief one. You introduce the problem, why we need to care about full headers. And what is extra difficult and challenging for these authors, and you know, this is an area that I did a lot of research in the past, and I can tell you there are hundreds and hundreds of different full header designs out there in the literature. And so if these guys want to publish yet another paper on that topic, then it's extra challenging for them to really make that argument that no, what was done so far is still not good enough, and we came up with something brand new and improved this design even further, and these are the benefits. Okay, so you can see the first sentence is very generic. Increased usage of battery-operated portable devices. So this is to the notion that
we, right?
That's what they say. Targeting low power.
So of course, they need to make that connection.
All right. We have battery-operated portable devices, cellular phone, PDAs, notebooks, blah, 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 blah. Demand new designs with improved power efficiency, power delay characteristics. And then they introduce still, these are the full headers being one of the most fundamental building blocks of all the aforementioned circuit applicators, remain a key focus domain of the researchers over the years, one and two. right? So this is where you acknowledge everybody. Different logic styles, each having its own merit, and bottlenecks was different logic styles, you should be aware. Investigate to implement one bit full adder cells, 3 to 11. So you lump everybody together, and basically you give credit to all these guys. So everything that is right here, 1, 2, 3, all the way to 11, is everybody who was working, all the different groups that were working on full adders in the past. And you can see that by looking at the references, that some of them are pretty, outdated. You know, this is, as I said, this was investigated so many times, over and over again. So that's why you see 2007, right? This was published in October this year, right? So you see 8 years. This is 8 years old. 9, 9. This is 12 years old. This is from 97. Right, 2005. So you can see the most recent one is here, 2010. 2010, the most recent one. So 5 years ago. So last one that last time that somebody published something at some conference was 5 years ago. So when you are a reviewer, and we will be doing this. Towards the end of this course, this is one of the first things that you need to answer and convince yourself, okay, I received a paper that I'm asked to review as best to my knowledge as I can. This might not be completely my area of research, but by looking at the references, I see that there hasn't been done anything recently. Now, why is that? So why not everybody sort of stopped working on it and nothing was done? And why then are these guys, after so many years later, they work on it and now they're claiming that it's still important? So you need to be, when you read the introduction and the justification for this work, they need to convince you that there is still room for improvement. And the results that they got are actually valid results, and they demonstrate that improvement. Right, so that's what it's important. And so, going back, so now I'm going back to the introduction. All right. So you see, so you kind of do a motivation, and then make a generic statement where you lump all the researchers that work in this area, you lump them together. But then, with the next line, starting here, you start describing each one of them individually, right? So this is a paragraph where, in general, you describe this area of research that was published in literature. And then, from here, down here, now you go to specifics, and you about each piece of work that you found in the literature that essentially is your competition, and you are comparing yourself to, you give a little description about that work, and usually you point out the advantages of that work and limitations. You make sure that you are not, there is acceptable criticism of previous work that you're trying to compare yourself, and then there is unacceptable criticism. So if you start trashing the other people's work, then they will not look at you very favorably. But if you describe certain limitations that the problem the authors themselves mentioned in that paper, because this is something now that is expected, this is required, or it's very expected, I should say. It's not still mandatory, but it's very common that the reviewers will ask for it. So if any time you propose something novel, they will want you to describe very precisely what are the circumstances under which this novelty actually provides all those benefits. You cannot make very sort of generic bold statements like, oh, you know, I invented this and it's the greatest invention ever and this is it. You know, I solved the problem, nobody else needs to work on it anymore because he can do anything in the world. Because people will find some way to demonstrate that what we invented might be good, but it's very good for a specific either operating conditions or specific, you know, environment or whatever, or it could be data specific. They'll find a way how they will be very offended if you start making generic statements. So very important is that you, in your introduction, you describe all the other previous work that was reported in literature, and this has to be published in a place that is generally acceptable to everybody or accessible to everybody. Okay, so you cannot have in a reference, you know, oh, I went to a conference and you know, such and such guy told me during the poster session. So no private communication or email communication. So something you know, there are a lot of research institutes that publish their own. They have their own publications, but you know, they're not readily part of any kind of major database. So it's extremely difficult to actually get hold of it. So those are also references that, if they are difficult to get, they shouldn't be on the list. Or it's a journal paper that is you know, an online paper, a journal paper that is run by some publishing company, you know, in Kathmandu, Nepal. Nobody can get to it unless you write them a real letter and they'll reply to you. You know, things like that. And there are a lot of, especially today, a lot of all kinds of publishing houses emerging all over the world. So it's very, very important. When you construct your reference list and when you refer to previously published body of work, that these are publications that are available through the, you know, sort of the mainstream databases. Okay? Now, another important factor. So after you introduce all the previous work and notice what is the proper reference to certain, you know, somebody's work. In that publication, there's a lead author, usually. And that's what you describe, you mention by his or her name, the lead author, and then, of course, if there were more of them, then you use the phrase et al, that means and others. You don't write all authors' names, and I'll show you in the other publication. That's why we have it here. It's a kind of not unacceptable, but it doesn't give a good, especially when you are somebody who nobody knows yet, and you're trying to make it to this forum and to this arena. If you don't mention people by name, then it's not looked very favorably upon. So I'll show you what I mean by that. So always mention the first name of the author, or here, and then the reference number. And then you can see, you go to the end of the introduction, and what you see again is your results. So after you introduce everybody else, then the new paragraph starts, and you see, you can see the main objective of this paper, and then you summarize it, you know, almost carbon copy the abstract, because you want to keep on reminding the reader or the reviewer what is important about this work. And it's the data, the results that you achieve based on your investigation, right? This is the proof that the statements and the claims you're making are true. So you put it there again, you repeat it, constantly reminding them that this is, you know, this is very important to remember. And then, same thing, just this is just a sort of side note, same thing you do again at the end of the paper, after they read the whole thing. See, this is conclusion, the last section, conclusion, and in that conclusion, you stick it there again. You repeat all the results. So this is so, after they read the paper, then you want them to remember what is important. And you repeat those results again. Okay. So, next week we'll talk about, we'll start talking about what to put in the body of the paper and the use of figures. And there is a phrase, every figure is worth 1,000 words, and it's completely true. However, the figure really has to serve the purpose. So you have to construct the figure so actually you substitute truly those 1,000 words to describe it, and people would, even with the most visual ability in their brain, would still not be able to imagine it. So you have to use the figure, and it has to be legible, it has to be clearly visible, so and so on. We'll get to that next week. But what I want to now show you, so now let's look at the other long paper, all right? So this is another long paper, Transaction Circuits and Systems, regular papers. This one has, I think, 11 pages. You can see, again, the title, because it's a very, very technical journal, so the title, you know, all the reviewers are all experts, or you know, this is an area that maybe they're not doing research in it. Well, the reviewers are mostly the ones that are doing research in it. But there could be, in the worst case, somebody who knows very well enough, about the area and understands the area that can follow, he or she can follow easily the paper. So, title very specific. And again, what is it about? It's about a converter, voltage converter, that converts one DC voltage level to another, and it's for these applications, energy harvesting, right? So that's what is the work is about this type of voltage converters. And now, again, some key descriptive elements in the title, that what you're saying is, this is what makes this design that I came up with very special. It's 50 nanoamps, it's 300 nanowatts power, and it's sensitive. Three things. So whatever you want to highlight that are sort of the key takeaways from your design, that novel design that you're proposing, that's where they're going to the title. All right? And so now you look at the abstract, and again, same thing, so there is a very little, you know, a brief introduction talking about introducing the DC-DC. So it doesn't start like, we need to save the universe, so basically we rely on these converters. It goes to description of what these type of voltage converters, what their requirements are, typically. And then, you know, basically you have two sentences, and then you start the paper further explore. So basically, you describe in detail what is the fundamental principle in this paper. And again, you can see the bottom of the abstract. Very, very specialized, you know, detailed data. These are the results that you achieved. You here you highlight. This is your evidence that whatever claims you're making here that you invented, this is the evidence, the data that you received from those experiments.
And because it's a long paper, you can see the introduction is 2 pages long. And this, these authors
also, again, you're introducing the entire area of research to the reader, and you're introducing all the major players. So you're referencing those works that were published previously. Now here what I want to highlight is that this is typically what normally the editors or the chief editors would not allow it, or it's not really perceived as polite. You know, when you start the sentence with a reference number, it's not, you know, even in English language, it's wrong because you cannot do that. But as well, it's not considered polite because you can see that they don't name anybody by names. So what that says is basically that you are not really, you don't really care who are the people behind the work. you know, for you, it's just a number. And this is not how you make friends, all right? If you want to be polite, you always name the first author, and then you give the reference number. That way, you actually give a, you know, kind of assign a person to a specific work, and you never know when that person might be a reviewer of your paper, and you know, in the future, and it's just a courtesy that is majority of the time is used. But you still come across, and that's why when I saw this, I wanted to show it to you that. You can see that as well, and as a reviewer, if you are the reviewer and you see something like this, I always point this out, and I'll tell them, you know, right how it is that this is actually what it really means, the way that it's written, that it doesn't give a credit to the author or the authors, it just kind of substitutes them with a generic number. Could be a cultural thing. So, you know, you want to provide a feedback that is constructive. So,
but look at the, as I said, the introduction.
So, because this area of research is fairly complex, so they actually divided the entire area of research into 4 parts. Depending on each is concerned with a specific metric, and then they do a review. So you can see that normally the parts of the paper, the main parts are numbered using Roman numbers. When you go to a subtitle, then you use letters, right? So that's why you have here. Sometimes it's also used 1A, so the Roman number will precede the letter A. Going back to this, so the area is fairly complex, so that's why they divide it into 4 parts, and they provide a literature review of each part separately, and mention, you know, that all the prior work that was done and was published.
This is how you give credit to everybody who is doing research in this area. Okay? And then you can see the last block,
and always at the end of the introduction, you introduce your work. So you do perform the literature review and with the focus what each of those previously published results or you know the papers you mentioned what were the achievements, what were the benefits, and what were the limitations. And then when you introduce your work at the end of introduction, then you link it to those, usually those limitations. So you, how you improved on certain aspects that you were able to solve some of the limitations with your proposed work, and then that's where you introduce it. So they have an entire section here dedicated to essentially a summary of what their invention is. Sometimes, as you can see, it goes into this. This is very typical in the paper, where in your last paragraph of the introduction, you summarize the entire paper. What is, you know, how, what's included in every section. So you say in section 2, we have described the basic operating principle of our design. Section 3, we have described the different modes of operation of our design. Section 4 discusses the overall architecture. Section 5 discusses characterization results. Conclusions are drawn in section 6. So basically, you are telling the reader what, from now, they learn sort of the kind of a superficial level what the work is about. And if they are interested in a specific part, now they know where to go, and they can just skip some of the parts and go directly to whatever their interest is. Or they can read the whole thing. So you're just giving them an opportunity to better search through the paper. And this is also very typical, because you are helping the reviewer with the review to orient himself or herself in the paper. Instead of going and look for information. Okay, now, this last paper is a short, that's why it's called, it is in a journal that publishes short papers, short articles, and it's called Express Briefs. Sometimes there are names used such as letters, nano letters, or electronic letters. Those are as well describing short type of papers. And a short paper is basically you have one idea. Originally you might have submitted a very long paper, 12 pages, and you thought, well, I'll describe everything, I'll put there a big motivation, big introduction, put a lot of stuff there, so it's kind of a learning experience for those reviewers as well. And oftentimes, the reviewers, especially those that work in your area, they are not interested in all that, other stuff. They just want to read the core of your idea, so they'll tell you, remove half of the stuff, make it into a brief, and just describe your work, nothing else. Nothing else we're interested in. So then you have to construct it in such a way that everything, the space becomes the greatest, the most valuable commodity that you have. So, titles tend to be longer in short papers, because you want to find the first, you cannot really talk about these things in introduction or abstract, because you don't have a really space for it. So you are trying to give them as much important information as possible right off the bat. So this paper is about time interleaved, successive approximation, analog to digital converter. So that's the design. Okay? And then now again, what is special? What is so special about it is what is in front of it. 220 megasamples per second, it's 9-bit. actually has a low input capacitance, and figure of merit is 37 femtojoules per conversion. That's the power consumption. And it's implemented in 65 nanometer CMOS. So what it means is you are highlighting each one of these. Each one of these attributes or parameters are something that wasn't achieved before or wasn't done before. That's why you're putting in the title. So people see it right away that, oh, nobody was able to build this kind of converter in 65 nanometer. So you're telling them, oh, you know, we did it. And here it is, you know, read about it in the paper. Or nobody achieved this kind of sampling rate with this size of the converter. And again, you know, you're telling them we were able to do that. So those are important results. And again, so your, as you can see, the abstract is very brief. You start right away. This brief presents and what it does. And the last two sentences, the results. You highlight what you achieved. Then, introduction, very much, much shorter. As you can see, it's less than a page. And basically, you focus on previous work. You still include everybody, or the most important ones. When you look at the references, in brief, it's this one is maybe a little bit even on the higher side. Normally, it's 15 or less. You know, these guys put 17. Another important aspect is that you want to show that your work is relevant, and so and that you are aware of every other researcher that is working in this area. So you have to put their most recent publications, because this is one thing that people will look at, you know, whether you are referencing work that is the most recent. And you can see they have September 2015, they have very recent. So that just shows that you truly did the literature review and found all the papers late as just in September. This was published in this month in November, this paper. So you can see how quickly these papers can be published. And they are typically published first online and then the hard copy is like 1 year later. So, okay.
Can I ask concerning the title? Because last time you said that we shouldn't put their abbreviation. Is this any abbreviation which are probably well known in a field, but when?
Yes, absolutely. You shouldn't. But why, for journal papers that are very technical and very specific, these acronyms are standard, very well known. So if somebody looks at ADC, so anybody who works in electrical engineering or in circuit design knows that that's the acronym for analog to digital converter. And if you put SAR in front of it, so that's successive approximation. Figure of merit. So there are CMOS, you know, they are very well known and very well established acronyms. So the audience, because the audience, even though they still spell it out right there. But because these are very well established already, so it's okay to use them. So you know that. Nobody will read it who doesn't know what it all stands for.
How to decide if to spell them later? Because I know that, for example, in chemistry, when they analyzes, they very often just use the acronyms and don't spell them.
Yes, so typically they should be spelled out somewhere, you know, early on, just in case that you might have somebody from, you know, industrial engineering who is building something and they need a data converter on, you know, in their system and doesn't know anything about data converters, so he's searching for just you know, that phrase, right? And so you might still have, you know, readers that might not recognize it, what it is. You know, there is, many publications have a limit on how long titles can be. The tendency is to have, you know, this is a little bit too long title for, you know, if I'm a reviewer and I see this, I would question some of these, you know, why you need to have this here. This definitely, you know, like, it would just explain, everybody fabricates or produces circuits in this kind of technology, is very common. So unless it's very unusual for this kind of design to be this technology, so that's the reason it has to be in the title. But so I would simplify it. But you know, this is probably as long as it can get. I haven't seen a title that goes over four lines ever. So again, it's, you know, who will be reading it? If you're submitting it to the journal and you know that it's pretty much the expert in the area will get it to review, then it's fine. If you're sending it to a conference where it's in, you know, it is in, could be in electronic design, but you don't know from which segment of it, you know, who will get it and who will review it. And so then you have to approach it, you have to rewrite it in such a way like we talked about it last time, make it more friendly. You know, if you, because I've seen oftentimes that if you write something very technical and you submit it to a conference, it can be, it can give an impression like you know, you're trying to show yourself that you are very knowledgeable in the area, and then because you use a lot of technical terms and you know that, you know, that in that conference, it could be conference about, you know, I don't know, automotive electronics, and there could be people from all kinds of segments of that area, and your paper would be or can be sort of perceived that you are almost asking for them to accept your paper because you claim to be a big expert if you write it in such a way that it's very hard to follow for anybody else other than your advisor. Right? So there are these little things that you have to take into consideration if you, you know, want to achieve the, you know, the success is that you write a paper, you want it to present somewhere, or you want to have it published somewhere, and that's your main objective. It's, you know, 60% is the work itself, 40% is everything around it. Any other questions? So what I would like you to now do is, for homework, is the paper that each one of you selected as paper from your area. Remember that we, you know, so look at that paper and just email me a few things, these just observations. How long is the title? Does the abstract have introduction or just goes right into the introducing the paper? Are they specific data in the abstract? How long is the introduction? Is the introduction, you know, also have a motivation and then introduces the literature review and then finally concludes with the introduction of the work itself? How many references there are? If it's a journal paper, do they refer to other papers from the same journal? How many there are these references? So these kinds of observations. Okay, and then you know you can see on your own. This is not really a homework, but because eventually you have to learn what is sort of the unwritten tradition for that journal that where you want to publish. So you observe on a few of these papers. Is it kind of a consistent that everybody is writing these the papers, the constructing these papers, similarly. There is such a thing as having too many references, and of course there are, it's more dangerous to have you miss one reference and which can kill the paper, as opposed to paper be rejected by having too many references. There is no such thing. But if there are too many, especially giving credit to people, you can really stretch to a limit where then they will tell you that it's not necessary. Like it's you write a sentence and then you put 25 references in it that everybody is working on this area. And they'll tell you, now just pick, most recent three and that's fine. So you will get that guidance from the reviewers. But the biggest problem or mistake is when you miss a reference. Then it's usually a resubmission somewhere else. Okay. Anything else? Any other questions? So next week we will talk about the constructing the main body of the paper.
I think it should be that we are missing the second page.
Really? Which paper is that?
Both of them. Both of them.
I told him it's double-sided. Okay, so what I'm going to do, what you can do, you have, everybody has the title page, right? So go to Google and type in the title. And it'll show up as the first line in the IEEE Explorer database and download. Sorry about that. I told them that it's double-sided, but they probably